Okay, in his ruling, the High Court Justice Stephen Musota directed the independent journalist Andrew Mwenda to pay former Vice President Dr.Specioza Wandira Kazibwe 200 million shillings over a case he handled to do with the dam in Karamoja sub-region. Now we speak to former Vice President Dr. Kazibwe about this hefty story that cost her two international jobs, including one at the African Union Commission in Ethiopia. Welcome, Your Excellency, Dr.Specioza Wandira Kazibwe.
It's a pleasure to meet you.
There has been a lot of issues to do with health, doctor's strike, the case that you just won in court against veteran journalist Andrew Mwenda. But before we go to that, you're still looking young. What keeps you looking that age?
I look like this because now, in a way, I'm serving myself. I'm loving myself more. I'm doing the things that make me happy.
Your Excellency, what is your assessment on the current health state in the country?
To me, according to Ugandans, most Ugandans are healthy because they are not needing to go to see a physician. But when you measure in terms of is the health equally distributed in the population of all Ugandans, I say no. Because the few who are very well off can access physical health support when they fall sick or medical care. Very few Ugandans are actually getting mental health support, and yet Ugandans are stressed. What is stressing them is because of the inequality that is becoming apparent in our society.
We see now doctors striking year after year after year. This not used to happen during your time.
Doctors going on strike, they should go on strike after they have made everybody not fall sick. That is the best indicator of doctors working well. So doctors striking to me is not an indication of how well we should do if they are paid well. It's an indication of the inequity in the distribution of national resources in terms of labor remuneration. Now, when we go to issues of how the doctors are being remunerated, it's also a symptom of how the public and the general health system is organized. Because when they striked in the public system, they went to the private sector and worked. We should not disaggregate provision of medical care. The way we manage the health system should be holistic, because wherever you go to treat anybody, you are treating a Uganda.
Your Excellency, we also see government still slicing the budget of the Ministry of Health. Isn't this going to worsen the situation?
To me, cutting the Ministry of Health budget and putting it in departments and programs of support that reaches the people in terms of helping them to stay healthy is more important than getting the ministry budget to buy drugs for malaria, to buy nets for malaria, to do all kind of antibiotics and that kind of thing. So, to me, the rationale is correct.
In the 90s, you championed the women movement in the country.
I'm still a champion because I'm still a woman.
What is your current assessment of the women emancipation in Uganda?
There are women in different sectors. We needed women to showcase management. We have enough showcasing politics. Whether they are doing a good job or not, that's for Ugandans to judge. Now, what we would like to see is more women in the boardrooms to influence programs, boardrooms, policies are already made, but the boardroom is where resources are distributed.
You were one of the few beneficiaries at that time, but we are seeing that you are in leadership positions beating or defeating men in constituencies at parliament level, at local government level. Do you still need this affirmative action?
Now, the tradition that you see men accepting women in a non-affirmative position is a tradition which we want to become part of our culture. That a woman can take over Obwakabaka bwa Buganda, just like Britain. Parliament had to change the law to say now, for them, it's now their culture. For it to become kati abakazi, they inherit. They become abasika. It is scattered here, like Saida Bumba, Honorable Bumba. She's the heir to her father's estate, and it is not a small estate. Now, we want those scattered to become part of the culture, that nobody even asks, how can it be a girl?
Your Excellency, you are one of the first women head of state on the entire African continent. How did it feel at that time?
Heavy, because at that time the budget was so small. You needed to work as a team to move, to talk to people, convince them to work with you. It was heavy responsibility. Now things should be easier because there is money, we didn't have these tablets and WhatsApp and whatever, where you can form groups and network. You needed to really go on rough roads to do a lot of work. The responsibility was really heavy, and the fact that I was the first one to be at that position in the whole of Africa, it was even worse for me, because the expectations of all African women were on me. And I was their torch, I was their leader. And by the grace of God, I think I managed to do it. And I continue to do that.
Yeah, Your Excellency, we saw you losing the African Union chairperson job. What actually happened?
Move out. So there are so many equations. And Ugandans actually, unfortunately, our analysis does not go to what is going on in Africa. What are the issues? Their main concern should have been, how come that election didn't take place? But I was eligible to stand again. And that's why you see me at AU still flying high.
We read in the press that the Valley Dam scam that was before court also cost you.
Your name is more important than money. This I must stress. Yes, I'm very relieved. But my relief has been legalized. Otherwise, before, the same issues came up when I was nominated by the Secretary General of the United Nations, Ban Ki-moon, to be special envoy. Ugandans again went there to say, she's corrupt, Valley Dams, to be nominated for that position. International police, Interpol, does due diligence. And Ban Ki-moon told them, we've done due diligence. And all these stories are political. A Ugandan very senior was fueling that. Don't make her, because for political reasons, people imagine that if I'm given such positions, I'm coming back for more politics. But for me, I'm now political every day.
Okay, Your Excellency, as a former head of state, do you think the NRM is still on the right course?
When NRM was here, there wasn't a single cell phone in the country. Actually, I'm the one who launched Celltel. When an NRM came, the roads were bad, so people could not move as freely as they are doing now. Now, the key thing that NRM said they would do is to make the environment peaceful enough for all Ugandans.
We saw the ruling by Justice Stephen Musota. You had asked for about 600 million shillings, and he ruled that you'd be paid 200 million shillings. Was this fair to you?
That's not little money. So they said, no, these things are coming up. And of course, your opponents, those who are vying for the same job, they bring this up. Yes. Yes. So 200 million is nothing.
Lastly, Your Excellency, your members of the NRM, why don't you leave President Museveni to retire after over 35 years, more over 3 decades?
For me, what I would like to see, whether it is Museveni now, if Museveni retires and you get another member there, they could also stay for 30 years. So it's not about Museveni, it's about building the institution of what a party should look like. I've said this even at the AU. So change the party.
Yes, yes.